Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Easter. Happy Easter. And we can be outside in this glorious weather. Amen. Well, we're going to get started here because it is Easter. And as much as I would just love to walk around and talk with all of you, we should probably have a ceremony, don't you think? Well, happy Easter to everyone who could be here present. Happy Easter to everyone online joining us from afar via Zoom. Again, if you have not received a program or bulletin, Peggy May is handing those out. And so raise your hand or honk your horn and she can come by and get you one. If you have not yet received the communion that we'll take today, our lovely contactless communion that we will have as part of our ceremony today. My dad is actually here handing it out, and so he is in the Washington Tractors hat, which I don't know which sports team that is, but apparently some team in Washington. So, but if you need communion, raise your hand and he can get to you. I'm sorry, I tried to go around and say Happy Easter to everyone. If I missed you, please take this as my Happy Easter that I'm sharing with you. And again, it's so nice to be joined in this time together today. We're going to keep announcements pretty brief this morning because after all, it is Easter and we all want to do all of our Easter things. But just to let you know that tomorrow the offices will be closed. You'll notice that I made sure to make that announcement. So tomorrow the offices will be closed. So if you need anything from the church this week, just please contact Diana on Tuesday or Wednesday. And then certainly we all are longing to be back inside at some point in time. And I just want to reassure you that we will be keeping in communication with you as much as we did this week. And if you received all the communications and read through them all this week, you'll know it was quite a bit. So thank you all again for being here today. Happy Easter Sunday. Christ is risen indeed. And let us take this moment of reflection now to center ourselves and prepare for worship. Oftentimes I forget, but I'm so excited at the beginning and so happy to see everyone, to thank those people that really helped make this day special. And so I want to thank, again, we have Maxine on the piano, Diana will be singing vocals, Amanda Lodd behind the computer, and Prescott behind the camera. I also want to thank Deborah and Joyce and Joni and all the hands that made this beautiful altar come together today. Who knew a picnic table could become such a beautiful altar? And so thank you for that. And I think they deserve a round of applause. And now, with hearts prepared for worship and centered on God, let us join in our call to worship together, either in your bulletin or on your screen. Christ is risen. Oh, and by the way, I gotta say this before we go. Today is about Easter and it's about Christ being risen. So if you see an exclamation mark, we need an exclamation, okay? Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hope is alive. Joy is alive. Love is alive.
A new age is dawned.
Forgiven and freed, we are alive.
Death and sin can no longer harm us.
God's love reigns eternal. Christ is risen. Amen. Hallelujah. Indeed. And you all did wonderfully. Thank you. Our prayer of invocation as we continue is also printed in your bulletin or will be on your screen. Let us join in this prayer together. God of grace and power, we come rejoicing in Christ's empty tomb. We come trusting in the good news that Christ came to give us. For the risen Christ is living proof that you care about our lives. Blessed God, the risen Christ offers us glimpses of hope, even in our tears. For even though the tomb is empty, it is not quiet. It speaks, it proclaims, it shouts the promise of eternal life. So be with us today as we celebrate our resurrection with Christ. Hear our resounding voices, lifting high the refrains of praise. Open our hearts to the promise made true through the risen Christ. And thank you, gracious and almighty God of mystery, God of surprises, God of eternal love. Amen. Our opening hymn today is Christ the Lord is Risen Today, verses 1 through 4. It's in the Methodist hymnal number 302. Words will be on your screen or in your hymnal packet. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah, indeed. And as we continue in our worship together, we come to a moment of sharing of peace with one another. There are so many that we want to share peace with, we want to bump elbows with, we want to perhaps honk horns at today. And so please join us online as we share in this moment of peace together as we are here. I'll have Prescott focus on the altar for those at home who share in prayers of peace, and let us here share safely with one another this moment of peace.
Peace. Peace. God's peace. God's peace.
Peace. Peace.
Peace.
How are you?
Jay asked me if I knew the Wi-Fi password here.
Okay. Generally, the people online do longer.
Happy Easter, God's peace.
What's fun about this is just like we are back inside the building, I get to welcome us back as we share peace together and come back. Please make sure you return to your own chair. Someone may be a little. And certainly God's peace to us all as we gather on this wonderful day. Again, in the sunshine and the rays of hope that God shines down upon us as we come together. And so as we indeed come back together from our moment of sharing in peace, it is with hearts at peace that we continue in our service and join in our prayer of confession. Our God who forgives, Easter morning takes us by surprise. We are awoken to confront the doubt and despair that has been rooted in our lives. If at any time we deny you out of fear or comfort, God, forgive us. If at any time we hide ourselves because the risk of discipleship is too costly, God, forgive us. When we wash our hands of responsibility and go along with injustice, God, forgive us. When power corrupts and greed overtakes, God, forgive us. So that in the bright light of your Easter love, O God, our sins would be exposed and your grace revealed. Raise us in your tender mercy, so that through the unconditional love of our Savior, we may witness to your awe-inspiring deeds. In the name of Christ, the risen one, amen. Hear now these words of assurance. The stone is rolled away. We are released. The tomb is empty. We are free. Christ is risen. Our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. I would like to invite Deborah up for our scripture readings.
Good morning and happy Easter to everybody. I'll be reading first from the book of Acts. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears the Lord and does what is right is acceptable to God. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witness to all that he did, both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in Jesus receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Next is from 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news I have proclaimed to you, which you in turn have received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaim to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe.
Our second hymn this morning is, O sons and daughters, let us sing, verses 1 through 3 and verse 5. Again, words will be on your screen or in your hymnal packet. Well, it is now time for our children's message, and Amanda Lott has a special children's message for the children this morning. So come forward, please, children.
Good morning, children. Happy Easter.
Good morning.
All right, I have something for you, but you can't open the container yet, okay?
Okay.
You two can share this when it comes time, okay? All right, so today is Easter. And why do we celebrate Easter? What are we celebrating? Jesus' resurrection, yeah? And why did he die? Yeah, to save us from our sin. So right here, I have an egg. There's lots of eggs for Easter, right? This is just a regular egg right out of the fridge. So if we pretend that the inside of the egg is us and my hand is God, what do you think the shell is? That's a good guess, yeah? Could be Jesus. Our sins, very good. Yeah, so the shell is keeping us from God, right? If you look at my hand, yeah. So our sins keep us from God, and Jesus died to save us from our sins, right? So we could be forgiven.
So
you can open your container. What is it? A squishy egg? Is it an egg without a shell?
Yes.
Yeah. You can see the yolk in there a little bit, can't you? Yeah. So you think of this egg, it's kind of a mystery. How do you think this happened? We don't know, do we? Kind of like how we don't know for sure how or why Jesus died for our sins, but we know it happened and we know it's true, just like you can see this egg without the shell, right? And it can remind us that Jesus died for us so we could be forgiven from our sins. Okay? So if you want to keep the squishy egg, you are welcome to. But I have another egg for you that you might like a little bit. Thank you, children. Happy Easter. No, I'm just pushing it.
How about a round of applause for Amanda and our children? If anyone wants a squishy egg, see Amanda after the service. Our gospel reading today comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Hear these words from Jesus. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus's head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that Jesus must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not recognize him and know it was Jesus. But Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me yet, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of our Lord. Will you please pray with me? God, indeed, we come here today to celebrate the empty tomb and fulfilled hearts, to rise in praise and glory your holy name that has been lifted through your Son, Jesus Christ. So open our ears, open our hearts, and help us, God, to receive your message on this, your most glorious day. Amen. We're getting a good all men from a train that'll probably be coming by here shortly. But as we begin today, I want to share a story with you, because today indeed is about an empty tomb, but about fulfilled promises. One time, Amanda and I were very fortunate, my wife Amanda and I were very fortunate to be able to take an anniversary trip to Italy. And there I was super excited because I was going to get to go to the Sistine Chapel and I was going to get to see one of my favorite pieces of artwork of all time, which is God reaching out to the human hand at creation. Well, we go through this tour, and of course, if you've ever been on a tour to get to the chapel, it's crowded, it's lots of people want to see it. And you get into this big room, which is the chapel, and it's a silent place. They even have guards standing there that if there's too much noise, they'll stand up to the microphone and say in Italian and English, please be quiet. And we're in there, and I'm looking at the ceiling because I know it's up there, but I can't find it. And I look, and I look, and I look, and I can't find it. Amanda and I even sit down on one of the benches along the side, and we're there for probably a good 20 or 30 minutes. And I look, and I can't find it. For the life of me, I could not find this artwork that I knew was there. You see, sometimes in life, we look so hard for something or expect something to be as it should be or as we would have it be. And that is not necessarily what our Lord has in store for us. And when we look hard and intently and we try to find it using all of our own efforts, we may even indeed miss it entirely. We may miss out on the message of Jesus like so many of the disciples did because they were so worried about following correctly, about paying attention to rite and ritual. We may miss out like the world of Jesus did on a Savior being present with us, for that world thought that the Messiah was supposed to come in an earthly form. That Messiah was supposed to take power. That Messiah was supposed to reign eternal as we would have it. If we expect things in our world to happen the way we expect them, the way we look for them, indeed, we will find that our world is full of empty promises, won't we? Empty promises of wealth that we cannot take with us. Empty promises that come with greed when we think we will gather more friends when in fact we alienate. Empty promises that we are even able to protect ourselves when it's God who we should be seeking for protection. Empty promises that come through our own ideas of providence for ourselves. Empty promises that may come through satisfaction we get through a job. Empty promises that come through any status or power that we indeed lord over others. And I would even add anything that we have created, man or woman created, ultimately becomes empty in the tomb. And in that emptiness, if we place all of our hope and trust in earthly things, if we strive after and look for God in all of our types and places in our world, then we truly receive an emptiness we cannot fulfill. But if we look in the empty tomb, if we listen to the words of Jesus, if we follow where God is leading us and place our trust and hope and faith in a Savior and in a God that is not of this world, but is beyond this world, who came for us, who came to forgive our sins and then left, because that is what Jesus promised us he would do. When we place our hope in this, promises do not remain empty, but are fulfilled. And it begs us to ask then in our lives, where are we looking? Where are we looking for Jesus? Where are we looking for God in our lives? Because if we listen to Jesus He told us where to look. He told us to look in the little children. Not one of you was not joyed and smiling at this wonderful children's message today. Children bring us the smiles and laughter. He told us to look in his Father's house. Where else would he be? He told us to look in the garden where he prayed alone on that night. He told us to look in the eyes of the outcast, in the eyes of our enemies, in the mirror that we should hold up for ourselves as we look in our own hearts and the places where we indeed keep treasure, for there we will find God. And on the night of his Last Supper, before Jesus died on the cross, descended and ascended through the resurrection we celebrate today, Jesus told us to look in each other. The ultimate promise that is fulfilled that we celebrate today is indeed the promise of eternal life guaranteed through this resurrection moment. And if we only trust in what we can see, if we only trust in what we can feel or taste or touch, then indeed that promise will remain empty because Christ is not there. Christ has fulfilled all promises, and Christ is resurrected. Jesus meets us in the emptiness. He meets us in the emptiness of the tomb. He meets us in the emptiness of our lives. He meets us in the moments when we need him most. He calls us by name. And he welcomes us home. Christ is risen indeed. Amen. Will you please pray with me? Our risen Savior, it's all for you that we come here today. It's all for you, God, that we come to worship and be with one another, that we come to feel this sunlight kiss us upon the face on this glorious day of your resurrection, that we come together to celebrate this most momentous day in our faith life, that we are reminded that the tomb may be empty, but it is a promise fulfilled. For you have ascended through the resurrection and taken us with you. You have guaranteed us an eternal life that is beyond the empty promises of our world. You have guaranteed us a place in the house that God built that has room for all of us. And you have guaranteed us that anything this world throws at us does not last eternally. For your world of love, of light, of hope, of promise reigns eternal. God, you did not send us Jesus to tell us that our load would be lightened, but Jesus tells us that we do in fact bear a cross. We experience the pain and sorrows of this world because we also experience the deep love and joy of this world. But what Jesus does tell us is that where we gather, you are there, and that we are promised an eternal life that takes away all struggles. Help us in our times of doubt to believe. Help us in our times of faith to be witnesses for others. And be with us always, God. Thanks be to your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Normally, we would open our time up at this point for prayers of the people. Today, I would just like to list the prayers that we have in our bulletin and read them off. And then in our time of silence, we can lift up what other prayers we may have. But please, God, hear our prayers as we pray for our brothers and sisters among us and those that have gone on before us. As we pray for LaVon Adams, Betty Benedict's family, Carla Brenner, Dacia Boltnick, Carol and Margaret DeFries, Alan and Denise Detert, Jim Hartle, Jim and Julie Holmes, the Echo Kowalczyk family, the LaFortune family, Doug Larson and Kathy Hartle, Betsy and Keith Manbeck, Bev Menz and family, Jeannie Meyer, Bill Morse, Martha Nornberg, Rich O'Quinn, Maxine Orton, Janelle Peters, Mike Potberg's family and family, the Quammen family, Tasha Rowland and family, Lloyd Schultz, John Watuki, Chaz Youngblood, our friends in Haiti, our students and teachers, and those impacted by COVID-19. And let us now join all of our prayers together in silence as we lift those prayers which are not printed, those prayers which are deep, and we need God to reach. And let us join all of our prayers, all of the prayers we have together in the prayer that was taught to us by our Savior as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who've sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We now come to a time of our celebration of Holy Communion. If you're here present with us and you still need some contactless communion, if you could please raise your hand and we will try and get you some before we actually get to the dispensation of this. As we gather together, hopefully you at home have your bread and cup to share. And as we gather together, we will indeed be invited together in our invitational hymn of I Come With Joy. This is in the Methodist hymnal number 617. Words will be on your screen or in your hymnal packet. But as we come, listen to these words, sing these words, and let them ring true in our hearts.
Joy to meet my Lord, forgiven, loved, and free. Then I'd wonder to recall his life laid down for me, his life laid down for me. I come with Christians far and near to find as our faith, the new community of love in Christ's communion bread, in Christ's communion bread. As Christ breaks bread and bids us share each proud decision blessed, the love that made us makes us one, and strangers now are friends, and strangers now are friends. And thus with joy we meet our Lord, his presence to God or none. We see and praise him here. We see and praise him here. Together met, together bound, we'll go our different way. And as his people in the world, we'll live and speak his praise. We'll live and speak his praise.
And let us now join together in our communion prayer as we continue with Holy Communion. As the prophet Isaiah foretold, on this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food. A feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And God will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. God will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces and the disgrace from his people. God will take away from the earth. For the Lord has spoken. And it will be said on that day, lo, this is our God whom we have waited for so that we would be saved. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in God's salvation. Indeed, God, we are glad and rejoice in the salvation we celebrate this Easter and every time we share in your resurrection feast. Amen. Amen, indeed. On the night of his betrayal, Jesus met with the disciples, and although he didn't have to deal with contactless communion and these wonderful different things that we have to do because of the pandemic, he nevertheless met with his disciples, and he took the bread, and he broke it for the disciples, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat of it and do so in remembrance of me." Likewise, at the meal, Jesus poured out the cup of the new covenant. And in sharing it with the disciples, he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you. Take and drink of it and do so in remembrance of me." When we eat of this bread, when we drink of this cup, we are realigning ourselves in the promise made true through the empty tomb that Christ lived, Christ died, Christ was resurrected, and Christ will come again. Let us pray. Blessed Holy Spirit, come upon our meal wherever we may be, in whatever place we may be, whatever meal we may be having, that you would bless this holy bread and cup, that you would bless us on this holy Easter and every day, that you would fill us and consecrate our lives with your Spirit, that all things would be made possible through you, through God, and through Jesus, our Savior. This we pray. Amen. This is the bread broken for you. Take and eat of it and do so in remembrance of Jesus. This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you. Take and drink of it and do so in remembrance of Jesus. Friends, the table has been prepared. Let us join in Holy Communion on this most holy Easter. brothers and sisters, let us then now continue our Holy Communion by saying our prayer of thanksgiving together. Hallelujah. Thanks and praise, ever-living God. You have worked wonders and miracles, conquered death, and set us free. Out of chaos and fear, you bring beauty and hope. Out of despair and death, you create courage and new life. And so, with the risen Christ, we too have been made new by the power of Jesus' resurrection and the blessings of this table. Amen. Friends, we now come to holy offering. We call this holy offering because it is indeed holy that we would give of ourselves as we felt able to give. Whether that is through money that you would like to place in the basket and give to the church or send in, the church definitely needs that, and that is holy. Whether it's through your prayers that you share at this time, because that is how you have to offer, that is holy. And if on this Sunday, this Easter Sunday, the promise came true to you of Christ's resurrection and that he died to save your soul, and you need to ponder that and what that is calling you to in your life, then do that at this moment, because what greater gift is there than that? The children will be coming around with baskets, if you have money here or offering here that you would like to put in there. And for those at home and who are going to be sitting silently, let us now join in holy offering. us now, as we collect our offering, join in our doxology together. Let us join in our prayer of dedication. O God, you are the Easter One. You are the holy source of resurrection. You are the dancing spirit of life. We offer these gifts in gratitude for hope returned, for the mystery of your grace, and for the promise of resurrection. Amen. Before we close with our closing hymn and benediction, Deborah Boltnick, our wonderful lay leader who helped with this altar scene, would like people, if they want any of these flowers, to come forward and talk to her about taking some of them home. She will be up here after the service letting you know which things you can and cannot take. For instance, the picnic table does have to stay here. I'm sorry, that's one of the things that does need to stay here. But let us now join in our closing hymn together. He lives. This is in the Methodist hymnal number 310. Words will be on your screen or in your hymnal packet. And let us sing resoundingly, for indeed Christ lives.
Lift up your voice and sing. Eternal.
how about a special round of applause for Diana? It is not easy to sing outdoors and look at music in the sunshine. Yeah. Friends, today's benediction is an interactive one. Normally, I just stand up here and say, let us go and give words of peace and grace and love. But today, we all need to join in and say that Christ is risen indeed. And so when I hold my hands up high, that is when we will all shout so that they can hear us all the way in Royalton, that Christ is risen indeed. Brothers and sisters, let us go forth from this place. Let us not look for the empty tombs of our world, but let us look for the places where Christ is resurrected, in our hearts, in our children, in one another, and in all of the places where God's light is shining. And if you cannot find those places, perhaps it is you who are the light that needs to be shining in those places. Let us go forth today in the peace of Christ, in the love of God, and in our resurrected Savior. For
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen.